Good morning, everyone. This committee hearing is now called to order, and as we resume the hearing on the endo and security of tenure bills, we'd like to welcome everyone and thank everyone for being here. We'd like to recognize our guests, our Department of Labor and Employment Assistant Secretary Georgie Aragon, our President of the Federation of Philippine Industries, Mr. George Chua, the Executive Director of the Investments Assistance Center Board of Investments, Executive Director Raul Angeles, Pure Gold Price Club Incorporated, Ms. Elvira Gutierrez, the President of Philippine Retailers Association, and representative of SM Schumart, Attorney Paul Santos. Is he around? Ah, sir. Thank you. The representative of ECOP, Legal Services Manager, Mr. Robert Maronilla. The Executive Director of CDA is also with us, Director Ray Elavazo. The National President of PALSI, Ms. Roda Caliwara. Ma'am? PALSCON. PALSI. Mr. Ramon Bergado, the National President of Philippine Association of Detective and Protective Agency Operators Incorporated. Mr. Ramon Bergado. Yeah. Thank you, sir. I saw Sir Dan La Chica of SAPI, and I think we also invited the representative from the ITBPM Association. But just the same, I'd like to welcome all of you today. Magandang umaga po. The chair would like to give his opening statements. A quote from John Hume is a very good reminder for all of us. He says, and I quote, "When people are divided, the only solution is agreement." Close quote. We may have differences in our opinions or positions on the issue of endo, but I believe that there is already a growing consensus that endo must stop. From our previous hearings, we were better able to understand the nature of the problem with endo. On one hand, contractual work arrangement as one of the prevailing non-standard forms of employment is a globally recognized labor practice. Endo, on the other hand, is a scheme designed to skirt labor regulations and to deliberately deny our workers the rights and benefits they are entitled to. Ang endo po ay isang malinaw na pang-aabuso sa karapatan ng mga manggagawa at dapat na po itong mahinto. In our first committee hearing, we learned that our labor code was designed to recognize other non-standard forms of employment, including the contractual work arrangement. Unfortunately, this well-intended well-intentioned policy also led to unintended loopholes that paved the way for the persistence of abusive schemes such as endo. Napakinggan din po natin noong nakaraang pagdinig yung pong iba't ibang posisyon ng ating iba't ibang grupo ng labor unions, mula din po sa ating Department of Labor and Employment, mula din po sa Department of Trade and Industry, mula din po sa Cooperatives Development Authority, mula po sa Joint Foreign Chamber of Commerce, maging ng ILO at ACADEM tungkol sa issue ng contractualization. Sa mga posisyon po nila, mas lalo nating naintindihan at mas lalong naging malinaw at mas malawak ang ating pagkakaunawa sa issue ng endo. Labor unions confirmed that endo remains a persistent problem. Because of this, workers are unable to receive the benefits they are entitled to nor enjoy the right to security of tenure, making them even more susceptible to abuse and harassment. The Department of Labor and Employment is acting on this problem, But even Secretary Bello himself believes that we need to amend our labor laws to allow them to combat unfair labor practices. According to DTI, the nature of work is evolving due to supply chain globalization. Hence, we need to recognize in our labor policies other non-standard forms of employment. Chairman Rabanera of the CDA stated that cooperatives, including those in the business of providing labor services, must conform with the country's labor standards, while Dean of Reneo of UP School of Labor and Industrial Relations emphasized capacity-building mechanisms for small and medium enterprises. On the other hand, the Joint Foreign Chambers of the Philippines challenged us to look into this issue in the broader context of skills development and apprenticeship programs to make Filipino workers globally competitive. Sa bawat isa po sa atin, today we are eager to hear from the representatives from various stakeholders, retail companies, manpower service providers. And I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all of you for responding positively to our invitation, especially to hear your positions, especially on the allegation that endo are prevalent in your malls, in your supermarkets, and of course, to enlighten us about the hiring of seasonal workers. I know that this past couple of months, this issue is making higher demands on ourselves because we are finding the best that we can contribute to the general welfare of our workers. And I put my faith and hope that through these hearings and panel consultations, we can agree on a piece of legislation that will put an end to endo, not just to more than 10,000 employees regularized the past couple of weeks and in the past 100 days of this administration, but to millions of Filipino endo workers. Again, maraming salamat po at muli magandang umaga. At this juncture, as we have heard in the previous hearings, the positions of DOLE, DTI, and CDA, may we now hear our invited guests. Let's start with ECOP, Mr. Robert Maranilla. Sir, you are recognized. You have the floor.
Hi, good morning, Mr. Chair. Yes, I would like to comment on the prohibitions on contracting first. We would like to reiterate that contracting out work is an exercise of management prerogative and business judgment. Such prerogative is not only acknowledged in Article 106 of the Labor Code, but is premised on the constitutional rights of employers, mainly right and freedom to contract and right to property. This doctrine is also entrenched in our jurisprudence. My second comment will be about the deletion.
Just to clarify, your first comment is about contracting.
Job contracting.
Which means, as I mentioned earlier, that it is a globally recognized scheme.
Yes.
But you don't agree also with the. When you talk about endo, when you talk about 555 scheme, when you talk about
we are totally against 555.
Thank you, thank you. Just to make sure that yes, it's clarified. Thank
yes,
you,
sir. Yes. Our second comment would be about the deletion of the phrase "while such activity exists" in relation to casual employees. In the Senate Bill Number 217. It seeks to amend the second paragraph of Article 280 of the Labor Code. It says, unemployment shall be deemed to be casual if it is not usually necessary or desirable or related to the usual business of the employer, provided that any employee who has rendered at least 1 year of service, whether such service is continuous or broken, shall be considered a regular employee with respect to the activity which he is employed in, and his employment shall continue while such activity exists. These four words were deleted in Senate Bill Number 217, and the effect of the deletion of these four words, "while such activity exists," has a subtle effect of transforming the tenure of casual employment into an indefinite period, even if the activity no longer exists. So that's our comment on that. Our last comment would be on the, as regards the continued employer-employee relationship, even after the completion of project, extra, and seasonal employment. My last comment is about the continued employer-employee relationship even after the completion of a project, extra, or seasonal employment. The pertinent bills would virtually transform seasonal and project employment into a perpetual employment, as it imposes employer-employee relationship where none exists anymore. As a result, forcing employers to regularize seasonal and project employees who offer and render services to other employers either at the beginning or end of the season or project is legally and constitutionally questionable as violative of right to property and freedom of contract. That's it, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Maronilla. Before we propound some questions, siguro we will try to finish all the positions muna. We go with the FFCCCI. We have a... Are they around? Not yet? Oh, okay. We'd like to hear from the President of Federation of Philippine Industries, Mr. George Chua. Sir, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Senator, for giving us the opportunity to be here with you today. First of all, I would like to say that businesses find contractualization actually very expensive. No, it is so expensive for us to replace people after every few months, primarily because of the additional training, familiarization, and everything else associated with having a new employee. And at the same time, when we go through different agencies, manpower agencies and things like that, it's actually more expensive for us as well, because we do have to pay their agency fees, no? Which ranges anywhere from maybe as low as 5% to as much as 15%. So that makes the overall industry actually less competitive in comparison to our, let's say, ASEAN neighbors, no? Because we're in a borderless society when it comes to ASEAN, and that makes it more difficult for us. So why then has this endo or contractualization become such a problem, or why have companies resorted to this kind of practice? The answer to that is because of the security of tenure provisions, which makes it almost impossible to lay off employees. And the reason for having to lay off employees is, I think, broad and varied, no? Such as a company sometimes need to right size. There sometimes is a downturn in the economy or in the industry. Sometimes the employees lack certain technical skills and are unable to comply with them. Sometimes also they are unable to get their own certifications, their own professional licenses and things like that. And also we encounter a lot of attitudinal...
I think everyone would like to know the fact that Senator Manny Pacquiao just came in. So we'd like to recognize our dear colleague who is also a member of this committee. Senator Pacquiao is recognized. And please continue, Sir George.
Good morning, Senator Pacquiao. So as I was saying, the problem with the security of tenure arises because we need to lay off certain employees due to certain deficiencies, including attitudinal problems, no? Mm-hmm. There seems to be a lot of situations wherein after employees have become regular, their attitude towards work becomes less important. No, it's almost like work has become an inconvenience for them. And of course, we also encounter problems when it comes to conduct, such as taking liberties on company properties and so on. So essentially, I think if we can cure the security of tenure problem by making it easier for employers or companies to be able to lay off or replace or retire or just simply fire employees, then that would solve all of the input problems when it comes to labor contracting. And at the same time, I think it should be less a requirement as to justify and things like that. But I think maybe what we can do is we can just offer to give them like a separation pay of, let's say, half month for every year of service, and let it be over with so that the companies can move forward. That's all I have to say, sir.
Later, we'd ask the Department of Labor to comment on these positions. Let me give the floor to Senator Pacquiao, as he is very eager to ask questions, and he's going to another committee hearing. Ganyang kasipag yung pambansang kamao.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, guest. May tatanong na ako yung Pangulo natin talagang mahigpit at pinapahinto yung Indo. Anong reaction nito? Pabor ba kayo dito? Ginagawa niya na ba ng action ito?
Mr. Senator, kagaya nga ho nung nasabi ko bago kayo dumating, ang mga kumpanya po, ang industriya, ay actually nahihirapan sila sa contractualization.
Do you have any proposal to counter yun nga, para hindi naman kayo maapektuhan?
Kasi actually, ang proposal ko nga ho, dahil kasi napakamahal sa amin ang contractualization, dahil kasi magbabayad ka ng mga agency fees at magre-retraining ka ng bawat bagong tao, ang solusyon ho na isasaad namin o naiisip namin ay sana ang pagpaalis naman o pagretiro ng mga empleyado ay gawing mas madali.
Dahil kasi excuse me, sir. Meaning you are agreeable na mas mahirap pag may contractor.
Correct. Ang problema,
so you want a direct hiring?
Actually, maganda nga ho yun. Ang problema nga lang ho, kaya yung ibang kumpanya ay hindi maisapatupad yan, ay dahil kasi nga ho, pagka na-hire na nila yung empleyado, halos ikailangan ipasara ang kumpanya para magpa-lay off ng mga tao.
And when you talk about that, you're also aware of the security of tenure.
That's right. That's right, ho.
Parang ano yun, ah? Parang less than one round yun. Ah. Anyway, just for the information of the body, on Senate Bill 1116 of this representation covers just and authorized causes for termination with the... I'm sorry, with the... Ano to? With the... Pwedeng paki... The effect of ensuring less litigious firing process by making it transparent through company rules and regulations in just cause. So ang bottom line ko, Sir George, if you were able to see the different bills, part of this committee hearing is to tackle all these bills, and one of which is Senate Bill 1116. And I agree, no, and I would like to put this on record that the intention of this committee is not to scare the investors, not to hamper yung growth ng mga companies, especially the small and medium enterprises. And so we are here to balance everything out, no? Kaya kanina binanggit ko rin, hindi naman din ho po pwede na ayaw nyo lang yung get up ng isang empleyado, eh, sasabihin nyo, lumayas ka na. So, yun naman po yung gusto nating i-raise dito sa committee na ito.
Actually, ho, tama ho kayo dyan. Ano? Meron ho kaming pagkakataon na ang empleyado ho ay nahuli na ng nagnakaw, no? Naka-blatter na at may kaso na. Eh, natalo pa ho kami sa NLRC for illegal dismissal. So, ang nangyari pa ho, in order pa kami na i-take back yung tao after 2 years na may back pay pa, no? So, kuminsan ho, napakahirap ho magtrabaho sa ganyang sitwasyon na... kailangan ho i-balance ho ang pangangailangan ng mga empleyado naman doon sa employers. Dahil kasi nga ho, kung mapapansin nyo, marami ho mga tayong neighboring countries na napakadali sa kanila mag-fire ng tao. At isa pa hong gusto kong sabihin, ang alam ho natin ay lahat ng Pilipinong OFW ho, kung mapapansin nyo, ay maraming magbubuting masasabi ang ating mga employers, foreign employers, no? Dahil kasi sasabihin nila, ang galing-galing ng mga Pilipino, mahusayan, and, you know, masipag at lahat. Dahil kasi ho, dun sa mga bansang pinagtatrabahuhan nila, alam nila kung hindi sila mabuti sa kanilang trabaho, napakadali silang tanggalin. Kaya po sila nagsusumikap. So I think it helps the attitude of and the conduct of people if they know that it's easier for them to be paid, to be laid off if they don't do their jobs well.
Thank you, sir. No, considering yung position po ninyo, maybe we can hear from the Department of Labor and Employment a comment on this. Siguro hindi na yung buong position, but on that particular subject matter, for instance, nahuli na yung employee na nagnakaw. Siguro may CCTV, nakita, ninakaw, o tapos...
Caught in the act ho, dahil kasi nung paglabas niya ng gate, eh, dala-dala niya ho yung gamit na ninakaw eh.
So, puntahan ho natin yung policy natin, no? Yung sa ganung klaseng pagkakataon, nahuli, caught in the act, pero ano ba yung process, ano ba yung tamang paraan for the employer na... yung right niya na nakita niya, ninanakawan na siya nung kanyang sariling employee, ano yung dapat niyang gawin? And before you answer this question, no, I'd like to put on record dahil baka ma-misinterpret tayo dito. Noong nakaraang hearing po, bumabaha tayo ng labor unions dito. Puro labor groups at lahat po, halos lahat ng kanilang posisyon ay napakinggan natin, nalaman natin, and... of course, gusto nating balansin, kaya ngayon, in-invite naman natin ng iba't ibang mga samahan ng kumpanya, maging iba't ibang industriya. Sige po, Asik Joji Aragon.
Mr. Chair, magandang umaga po sa inyong lahat. Thank you for the invitation, and Secretary Silvestre Bello extends his greetings to the...
Congratulations to Secretary Bello for passing the... being confirmed in the Commission on Appointments.
Marami pong salamat, sir. We are profoundly appreciative. Sir, on again, allow me to just reiterate the position of the... it's the directive of the President to end this very abusive form of illegitimate form of contractualization, itong endo ho. So dito ho nakasalalaw ang aming programa under the leadership of Secretary Bello to stop prohibited form of contractualization. Natutuwa din ho kami sa opening statement ng ating honorable chair that you mentioned also that under the Labor Code of the Philippines as amended, meron din naman ho legitimate forms and allowed forms of contractualization. So, klaro po yun. Again, let me repeat that there are three approach that the Department of Labor has adopted. Number one, we will certainly strictly enforce the law right now under 106 to 109 of the Labor Code. I-enforce po natin ito strictly through our mechanisms, our labor inspectors, or the LLCO, the labor law compliance officers namin. And this is the reason why under this first mechanism namin of strict enforcement, nakapag-regularize na ho tayo ng more than 12,000 employees under a voluntary compliance regime as of October 7 of 2016.
That's a very commendable move on the part of the department, no? Ma'am, just to, because we are pressed for time also, can we just comment on that particular statement made by Mr. Chua?
Mr. Chair?
Kung yung policy lang natin, no? Kasi I think it is important for companies, definitely, no, to establish clear metrics and indicators in evaluating employees to balance yung and to find out yung efficiency ng employees. But this time around, if the employer would have enough evidence and overwhelming na nakita na caught in the act, nagnakaw, ano ba yung tamang paraan para pag-fire? Ano ba yung polisiya natin diyan na dapat gawin para i-fire? Kasi yung binabanggit po kanina sa atin ni Mr. Chua, finalan ulit sila pa yung nabaligtad.
So, sir, Mr. Chair, maliwanag ko, there are company rules and regulations that actually guide this particular incident. Pero sinabi nyo nga ho, under just and authorized causes, na klaro ho sa batas, sir, that there are allowable forms of na pwedeng i-terminate ang isang empleyado or isang worker, and nakapaloob ho ito sa Philippine Labor Code. So ito lang ho ang ating guide, just and authorized causes. Meron ho ditong set of parameters and criteria na...
And so maaaring hindi nila sinunod ito? Kaya ho, is that the...
At meron din hong notisya at dapat na kailangang sundin para i-advise ang ating mga empleyado tungkol sa parameter.
Yeah. Kaya po ito siguro, no, importante na mapag-usapan ito, kasi ito yung opportunity to find the middle ground through transparent procedure and clear and just grounds. Kasi parang yung you know, this is not the first time that I've heard about this. A lot of employers would talk to me about it and caution me, considering me being the chair of Committee on Labor and Human Resources Development. So importante po nito, no? But let us look into why endo or contractualization becomes a bad practice. Siguro doon natin i-limit yung ating usapin. So for that, mukhang may gustong ihabol ang ating executive director from DTI.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Based on our consultation with the industry, that main reason of difficulty in firing a employee is one of the disincentive for regularization of employees. And as mentioned, ito nagnakaw na, huli sakto, after 2 years, talo sila at pinabayaran pa ng back wages. Kasi under the process kasi dyan, merong notice ng term, they have to explain why they will not be terminated, and then if they will be terminated, they will be informed, and then they will complain of illegal dismissal sa labor arbiter. The decision of the labor arbiter will be elevated to the NLRC, after NLRC to the Court of Appeals, then after Court of Appeals, it will be the Supreme Court. It would take about, siguro, 10 years just to terminate under just or authorized causes. So yun ang sentiment nila, and...
Thank you, sir. I'm sorry to say this, no, parang hindi pa rin malinaw. So talagang kailangan ng mas malinaw na patakaran para maprotektahan din naman natin yung mga negosyante natin, lalo na kung grabe naman yung nangyari, no. Again, last hearing we heard about labor unions, and I commiserate with them, labor groups, yung mga nararanasan nilang napakadaming injustices din. But we have to balance, we need to balance yung security of tenure, accountability, and transparency of both employers and workers. At this juncture, let me just acknowledge Sir Gabriel Quemado II, representative of Union of Labor Service Cooperative. Sir, good morning. We'll proceed now with the position naman ng Philippine Retailers Association, He is our representative from SM Schumart, Attorney Paul Santos. Sir, you are recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. May I be allowed to deliver my opening remarks?
Yes, sir, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Senator. First of all, the Philippine Retailers Association would like to thank the committee and its chair, Senator Joel Villanueva, for the opportunity to participate in the crafting of various bills that seek to improve the rights of workers to security of tenure and to further regulate the business of service-only contracting. The proposals enumerated in these bills, if enacted into law, will certainly affect the way PRA members conduct their business in this country. It is in this light that the PRA strongly urges the committee to carefully study the above-mentioned bills to ensure that these proposals truly balance legitimate business interests with the need to protect workers from insecure employment conditions. A reading of the above-mentioned bills revealed that many of the proposals would most likely prevent Philippine retailers from quickly responding to changing economic and business conditions as they see fit. More so that what the existing legal framework, rigid enough as it is, already requires. These new clauses, if implemented, will compel employers to conform and thus add more weight to the regulatory burden Philippine businesses already carry, adding to the cost of doing business here. These new rules may also stifle innovation and discourage Philippine entrepreneurs from implementing new business models in the future, thus hindering future job creation. Moreover, some of these proposals may even run contrary to the Equal Protection Clause of the Constitution. Jurisprudence has already determined a fine balance already exists between the rights of management and labor regarding this issue, and that these new provisions will certainly upset it. The PRA stands ready to extend its cooperation with the Senate in crafting legislation that is both humane and respectful of rights of labor and management. Once more, the PRA would like to thank the committee for its time. Maraming salamat po.
Thank you, sir, Attorney Santos. At this juncture, we'd like to recognize our Senate President pro tempore, Senator Frank Drilon. Thank you, sir. And we also like to recognize, I recognized her a while ago, but she's here now, Ms. Jenny Marshall of the ITBPM. We'll call on Ms. Elvira Gutierrez, the representative of Pure Gold. Ma'am, you're recognized.
Good morning, Mr. Chair. Good morning, Senator Drilon. I am Elvira Gutierrez from Pure Gold Price Club. We are engaged in retail and wholesale business, and we have stores in certain regions in the country. If I may just commit submission of, in behalf of the management, of our comments, Mr. Chair, on the bills given to us this morning on a scheduled date, so we can further discuss this with our legal department. And if I may just share my opinion instead, I hope I can give clarity to the concern of Mr. Chua on the experience of an employer na nababalikan pa po kapag dinismiss yung employee. I hope I'll try to give clarity on that, Mr. Chairman, because we also experience the same thing, that after terminating a certain employee for grounds of qualified theft, they would normally file a case under the NLRC. So strictly for Pure Gold, we abide the two notice rule, because you were asking about earlier about the process. So there's this rule of a due of the provision of the notice to explain, and then if grounds is really for termination, we can put the employee under preventive suspension. Given 30 days, we have to make as employer a decision whether to terminate or bring back the employee. to his original position. So that is actually the long process after giving two admin hearing, which is also part of the two notice rule. So we religiously abide with that one, but the difficulty really is after legally terminating the employee, they would still sought help from NLRC, and there might be something that we can do, maybe we can do something about it. That upon filing, if maybe the papers can be reviewed by the desk officer so that it won't elevate anymore to the arbiter, maybe we can try to look at that process. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Ms. Gutierrez. We'd like to also recognize the one of the members of this committee, Senator Nancy Binay. Thank you. We'll call on Ms. Rhoda Caliwara of Falscon. Ma'am, you're recognized.
Thank you. Honorable Senator Joel Villanueva, Chairperson of the Senate Committee on Labor, Employment, and Human Resources Development. Good morning, sir. Good morning, Senator. Honorable Senator Franklin Villon and Honorable Senator Nancy Binay. First and foremost, I'd like to say that we, the Philippine Association of Legitimate Service Contractors, or PALSCON, support the position of the Employers Confederation of the Philippines, or ECOP. Again, the Philippine Association of Legitimate Service Contractors, Incorporated, or PALSCON, is grateful for the invitation of the Senate Committee on Labor, Employment, and Human Resources Development to participate in this public hearing on various legislative proposals pending before the Senate. We welcome the opportunity to be heard and share what our organization believes and stands for with regards with the issues of contracting, subcontracting, and security of tenure, which the proposals cover. During the course of this hearing and in future discussions, we will be most happy to answer any question of the committee with regards to legislative proposals, as well as on the situation obtaining in our sector and the challenges and prospects we face as a sector of the economy. We will also submit for the committee's consideration a written position on Senate Resolution Numbers 1, 11, and 96, and on Senate Bills Number 117, 174, 217, 302, 329, 1061, and 1116, as soon as we conclude our consolidation with our members. Your Honors, as the umbrella organization of the legitimate service contractors in the country, the PALSCON, which was established on April 14, 1987, by 30 local service contractors, represents and advocates the common cause, interest, and welfare, not only of the service contracting industry, but most important of all, the country's millions of workers and laborers. Over the years, PALSCON members, which have grown to over 250 members, have been the government's staunchest partner in generating decent employment, promoting and sustaining industrial peace and productivity, and enhancing the Filipino workers' competencies, knowledge, and skills. We are a self-policing industry organization, working hard to set the highest standards of ethical conduct and integrity for our members and promoting voluntary compliance with all labor laws and regulations, especially general labor and occupational safety and health standards, even as we faithfully abide and comply with state laws, rules, and regulations in the conduct of our businesses. We would like to make it on record, Your Honors, that the service contracting industry is already a key feature and element of the country's economy. We enable businesses for them to have the flexibility to meet today's multifaceted business challenges and to adapt to changes in the labor market that is increasingly volatile and complex because of globalization, technology shifts, demographic evolution, innovation in organization of work and production, and attitude to work. PALSCON, Your Honors, recognizes that these changes necessitate adjustment. It also believes that long-term employment, or what the International Labor Organization calls the lifelong attachment to a single enterprise employer, is increasingly not becoming the norm contrary to expectations, so much that non-standard forms of employment, including part-time, fixed-term, inflexible contracts, as well as instances where enterprises do away with a directly employed workforce, generally through processes of subcontracting, outsourcing, third-party agencies, and the operation of supply chains, are increasingly taking on a global dimension and acceptance. But of course, this does not distract us in PALSCON from the primordial concern in the state, which is to promote decent work, security of tenure, and the general welfare of the Filipino workers. The PALSCON is one with the government in the pursuit of these goals. Thus, we commit to respect and comply with all labor laws and the rules of law, compliance being the sine qua non of our business. We commit to strictly follow the provisions of the Labor Code of the Philippines as amended and focus industry compliance with all general labor standards and occupational safety and health standards. We have committed to end the so-called 555 and other abusive practices such as end of contract arrangements. We are working hand in hand with the government in uplifting the standards in the service contracting industry. Ethical and professional conduct is paramount to us. We faithfully observe our code of ethical and professional conduct as a business organization and subscribe to the highest principles of integrity, responsibility, accountability, and fairness in dealing with job seekers, workers, and client companies. We have been transparent in our engagement with the workers we employ, informing them in a manner and language they understand of their working conditions, the nature of the work to be undertaken, rates of pay, and pay arrangement and working hours. We are vigilant in ensuring their health and safety at work, getting out of our way to assess risk in order to promote the health and safety of workers in their workplaces. We respect our workers' rights and encourage them to exercise these rights responsibly, because PALSCON believes decent work also means universal respect for fundamental principles and rights at work, including social protection benefits and freedom of association. As it is true in all business activity, our people is our best resource in the contracting, subcontracting industry. Thus, we ensure that our workers are adequately trained, high-skilled, productive, and capable to undertake their work responsibilities, for we believe that quality service is the only way and no other for us to remain competitive, sustainable, and thus enable us to continue to contribute to a better functioning labor market. Thank you very much, Your Honors.
Thank you, Ma'am Caliwara. And you mentioned 250 members. How many employees again?
Well, we can't give you the exact figures, but we are estimating to be 300 to 400 employees. 300,000 to 400,000.
Thank you. We'll proceed with the representative from Union of Labor Services Cooperatives, Mr. Gabriel Quemado. Sir, you're recognized.
Good morning, Your Honors. First of all, we will submit our official statement. Our official spokesman and chairman is caught in gridlock, so I just was pulled over to give the opening remarks. No? And now, let me tell you a little bit about the Union of Labor Service Cooperatives, Your Honors. We have 30 member cooperatives. We have 400,000 employees, regular permanent employees. We pay about 62 billion pesos in salaries annually. We have remitted ₱1 billion to the SSS. We have remitted ₱500 million to Pag-ibig and PhilHealth. We have declared dividends to our members to the tune of ₱700 million. These are annual numbers. These are 2015 numbers. Our members are owners of the cooperative. They own the cooperative, they form the cooperative, they exercise one man, one vote. So they participate in the decision making of our cooperatives. Long before, we have never practiced endo. Long before security of tenure was being discussed, our members already enjoyed security of tenure, retirement, and separation. Because we have always considered them to be owners, secondarily as employees. Our members are protected by two laws. RA9520, which is the cooperative law, which ensures that they participate in the governance and the surplus created by the cooperative, and the labor code, which protects them as employees. So we are not capitalists. We don't own the enterprise. I don't own the enterprise. I represent a cooperative of 70,000 members. I am just one of the owners. So, Your Honors, my final statement is this. I would like to invite this body to look at cooperatives as an alternative model of worker organization and as an alternative model of business contracting. Our clients represent some of the biggest names in the industry. That's my opening statement, Your Honors. We will submit an official statement as soon as our chairman arrives in a few minutes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Quemado. It's very enlightening. We'll have two more from ITBPM, Ms. Jenny Marshall. Ma'am, you're recognized.
Good morning, Honorable Committee Chair, Honorable Franklin Dulon, and Honorable Nancy Binay. Thank you so much for inviting the ITBPM sector to be represented here today. So IBPAP, or IT and Business Process Association of the Philippines, is the enabling association for the fastest growing sector of the Philippine economy, the information technology and business process management industry. We currently have over 300 member companies and 6 partner associations, including the Contact Center Association of the Philippines for the voice-based industry. These are the call centers. The Philippine Software Industry Association, the Healthcare Information Management Association, the Animation Council of the Philippines, the Game Developers Association of the Philippines, and Global In-House Center Council. So these are all IT-enabled industries, sirs. Our members represent the 1.2 million direct employees and an estimated 3.6 million indirect employees. As an industry, we contributed $22 billion, or 8% of the country's GDP, in 2015. We have always maintained that our industry's primary asset is our employees. In fact, ITBPM companies spend more on recruitment and training than in any other business function. On basic training alone, excluding product-specific training, companies spend at least $20,000 per new hire. So this is for the foundational training. Those job applicants who could not even make the grade are given free training so they can qualify for ITBPM jobs. This is actually where we partnered with Honorable Chair's in his former life at BESDA, in the Train for Work Scholarship Program. So this is not even include expenses related to hiring, such as marketing and advertising. It therefore makes more sense for our companies to take care of their employees, retain and regularize them, and in the process benefit from a higher and better output, resulting from a motivated workforce. IBPAP respectfully submits that it joins DOLA in espousing fair labor standards and practices. Now, specific to contracting and subcontracting arrangements, IBPAP respectfully notes that contracting and subcontracting arrangements per se are not anti-labor if exercised within the parameters established by applicable laws, regulations, and jurisprudence. From the perspective of an employer, ITBPM companies should continue to have the flexibility to enter legally permissible contracting and subcontracting arrangements, including but not limited to obtaining security, janitorial, advertising and marketing, and other services from legitimate service providers, consistent with its constitutional right. As an employer, ITBPM companies are sometimes required by the necessities of its business to hire employees on a limited period. While not the predominant role of our member companies, this type of engagement does serve a necessary operational arrangement where seasonal, fixed-term, project-based, or similar ad hoc services are required. This becomes more relevant to the ITBPM sector, where scalability of services and accompanying resources are determined not merely by Philippine-based employers, but by business requirements of our foreign clients. As you know, 77% of all our clients are in the U.S. and Canada, and all over the world. We export services. Investors currently face other factors greatly affect the ITBPM industry's thrust to bring development and employment to otherwise untapped provincial locations and to offer higher value services to clients in other countries. Many investors are concerned about investing in the Philippines because they do not see any flexibility in managing their human resources to meet ever-changing business requirements and allowing them to remain viable in a competitive and complicated business environment. As you know, IT-enabled enterprises, the industry per se, has to remain competitive with other countries. And as you know, technology is fast evolving, and along with it, the flexible work arrangements are being now observed in other countries. In some other countries, actually, BPO companies have virtual offices. So most of the employees actually work from home, which is already now being discussed here in the Philippines. I do not believe that workers' right to security of tenure is already sufficiently protected by the Labor Code of the Philippines. Preventing employers from entering into valid alternative employment and contracting subcontracting arrangements would be unduly burdensome and restrictive. A total ban on contractualization will make the Philippines unattractive and will discourage entities from investing in the Philippines or expanding their operations. Consequently, rather than promoting the welfare of workers, legislating a total ban on contracting will be very discouraging for investors and will curtail employment opportunities all over the country. We believe that current laws and regulations already cover concerns on contracting and subcontracting. It is a matter of effectively implementing the current laws and regulations that need to be addressed. That's all, Your Honors.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And before we go to the last presenter, before we recognize the representative from PADPA, we'd like just to take this opportunity to clarify that we are recognizing the role of contractualization in the fluidity of labor. Our goal here is to identify bad practices in contractualization to ensure that we establish safety nets to also protect our workers. We now recognize Sir Ramon Bergado of PADPAW. Sir, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. May I greet the Honorable Senator Drilon and Honorable Nancy Binay, and of course, the distinguished resource persons and the media. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. At the onset, we would like to express our gratitude, Mr. Chair, for inviting us in this public hearing, for us to be able to submit our position and explain our side. But allow me first to give a backgrounder. PADPAW is 60 years old, founded in 1958 with 2,000 member companies and with 664 security personnel and guards per record of the Philippine National Police. We are against endo and or labor contracting, Mr. Chair. As a matter of fact, the security industry does not practice endo or labor contracting. While our relations with our principal client is contractual in nature, but our guards acquire regular status after serving 6 months, Your Honor. And even beyond the termination of the contract, they remain our employees. Under Article 286 of the Labor Code, there is something as floating status, wherein the legal implication of which they remain our employees. And we are mandated under the law to reinstate them within a period of 6 months. And failure on the part of the security agencies to reinstate them, this guard or guard are deemed constructively dismissed, and we are mandated to pay separation pay. And this is supported, Your Honor, by a Supreme Court ruling jurisprudence. Now, recently, for the information of this August body, we proposed the creation of a security industry tripartite council. Thank you for the labor executives who are here, wherein no circular will be issued by the Department of Labor without first consulting this body, Your Honor. And the first major output that we had is DOLE Circular 150-16, wherein all the benefits and rights of the guards are mandated under this department order, Your Honor. I will submit this DO-150 to the Secretariat. So we would like to reiterate our position, Your Honor. We are against endo and or labor contracting, and neither we are practicing the same. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Sir Bergado. We'd like to... I will give way to the most senior boss. Just to ask yung mga supermarkets, malls, merchandisers na naririto po, no? In supermarkets, what is the setup with respect to promodizers or merchandisers who exercises, I wanted to know who exercises control and supervision on the role of these employees on a daily business operations? Is it the contractor or the supermarket retail store management? Bernie Santos.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. In as much as the membership of the Philippine Retailers Association is mostly composed of stores engaged in the sale of apparel, footwear, appliances, I can only talk of this practice in a more general way. The exact specifics of the employment practices in supermarkets, I can only speak in that fashion. But usually, in the case of merchandises in the stores, these merchandises are normally belong to a service-only contractor whose services are hired by a partner, supplier, or manufacturer of the retailer. So in this case, control and supervision over promodizers vests not in the retailer, but in the service contractor that is in turn hired by the supplier that the retailer has a business dealing with. No? So
they're the ones who serve as principals.
Yes, that's right.
It's not the supermarket owners.
Yes, sir.
Oh, so if ever these employees are regularized, who will absorb these workers? So it's not the supermarkets, right?
Sir, it's the service only contractor that hired them that absorbs the regularization of such employees, not the supermarket, sir.
Okay. Ms. Gutierrez, would you like to respond?
Sir, on the specifics.
Turn on the microphone.
Sir, on the specifics, I definitely agree with attorney. On the specifics, we have partner suppliers. They hire their promodizer either directly from their own company or they outsource it from an agency. And these agencies would deploy these corporate merchandisers to supermarkets. So we do not exercise control over the promodizer. The terminology or the jargon is they present an introduction letter authorizing their entry and assignment to specific branch of a supermarket. Then we just accommodate them so that they can do the inventory, manage the merchandise, display their merchandise. So that's the specific process that we have for corporate merchandisers deployed in our supermarket.
So for example, yung supervision, Attorney Santos, no, kunyari, yung gupit, yung itsura, how they present themselves, hindi po kayo yung contractor.
Ideally, sir, yes, it's the contractor that is supposed to control these items of behavior.
And if they are late, if they are yung kailangang isanction,
it's the supplier.
What happens, sir, is the retailer makes a note of in the case of the attendance of these persons, and then delivers a report to, in this case, not directly to the service only contractor, but to their manufacturer partner, who then notifies their service contractor that some of such persons were late or absent, and it leaves it up to this entity to conduct the actual disciplinary process.
And if you need them to, if you need some training, additional trainings, what happens? Do you require the contractor to do it?
Well, usually yes, sir.
They do the training also?
Yes, sir.
What is the required duration of these trainings? For instance, nakita nyo kailangan pa ng further training. May mga ganito po bang instances, and how long does it take?
Your Honor, as I mentioned, since I'm not particularly familiar with the exact practices of merchandisers in the supermarket trade, so I will leave that to a more qualified person to reply.
Si Ma'am Gutierrez, would you know about this?
Mr. Chair, on our supermarket, we actually assume that the corporate merchandisers deployed to our branches have been trained already. So we do not actually require training anymore once they deploy these workers to us.
Yeah, and ma'am, kaya ako tinanong yan, no? Kasi yung last hearing, if the workers are not required to undergo specialized trainings, and we were talking about specialized services na po pwedeng i-allow ng usapan po nung nakaraang hearing, di ba, specialized services for a contractor, it means that you don't need the workers with specialized skills. Pagka ganun, I'm just throwing it to the body. Anyway, let's recognize Senator Drilon.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is the first time I'm able to attend this hearing. And I think I can claim some degree of experience here since. Now, just to put it in context, you know, this issue of labor-only contracting is closely, to my mind, related to the provisions on security of tenure under our labor code, imposing just causes for the termination of an employment. And it must be understood that PD 442 was enacted in an environment and a regime of martial law, where workers' rights were suppressed. And therefore, remedies were introduced, or safeguards were introduced into legislation or introduced into our system in order to provide protection to the workers, state protection to the workers, where because of the uneven circumstances between management and employer. Before management and the workers, before martial law, you can dismiss or you can terminate the employment by paying separation benefits. And where the separation or the dismissal is patently violative or is violative of the right to self-organization, you are ordered to reinstate the employee because of the state policy protecting the right to self-organization. But then, the right to self-organization was suppressed by martial law. And therefore, the state had to provide another avenue and remedy to the workers. And it is in that context, in my mind, that PD 442 incorporated this security of tenure and the labor-only contracting prohibition, because with the security of tenure clauses, the rights of the employer were restricted. I'm sorry. With the Yes, with the prohibition against unjust dismissal, then the employer looked for a way by which they can go around this provision. And therefore, they resorted to labor-only contracting. That's the history. The employers resorted to labor-only contracting because of the restrictions on the right to hire and fire. Now, so kung hindi ka pwede magtanggal ng empleyado mo, maghanap ka ng contractor. Pag hindi nagkabagtag, pag nagiging problema noong contractor. Now, so the law sought to prohibit that by now prohibiting labor-only contracting. And ladies and gentlemen, that was 42 years ago, 1974 to 2016. Eh, marami sa inyo siguro, hindi pa pinanganak, pati yung aking mga kasamahan dito. Kaya, now, so, the way I would see it, it's basically an interplay of considerations that we must address. Number one, the security of tenure of the workers. Number two, the benefits that the workers are entitled to. Number three, the flexibility in the management of the employer's affairs, of managing a business without running afoul with the law. So to me, on a broad plane, these are the three issues that we must tackle because ito talaga pinanggalingan itong problemang ito eh. Because of the restrictions on the right to self-organization, the law has provided a remedy in order that the workers, even if they do not have the right to self-organization, can be protected in their tenure. Now, which brings me to some questions from the Dole, to the Dole. Are there similar systems in other countries wherein the laws of that country provide for just causes of employment and you cannot terminate unless you fall under these just causes, even if it does not involve rights of self-organization? And are there regulations on labor-only contracting in other countries? Maybe ASEC Aragon can give us that information.
Thank you, Senator Dirigan, for the question.
Yes.
But we are in the midst of studying, sir, for example, the ASEAN practices with respect to security of tenure, flexibilities in work arrangements, and even on RSTO, right to self-organization. We are aware that we are in the midst, and we're trying to finish it by this month, with respect to, for example, what the flexibilities in Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand, even in Korea for that matter, sir. So we will report to you on that score. We are aware that there are flexibilities in, for example, in hiring and firing, but with respect to specific items, we would like to submit to the committee.
You see, we are working under a martial law type of regulation in a democratic and laissez-faire economic environment. That is why nahihirapan tayo. There are so many, I can see that the chairman is trying to figure out what to do with this issue, but I'm putting this on the table so that we will have at least a basis for debating on this and what really can we do. That is why I'm asking the Department of Labor. My impression is that in developed countries, there is no such thing as just causes for termination. In other words, you can terminate the employment if there is no just cause. You pay separation benefits. in developed countries. Is that a correct assumption?
Opo, Mr. Chair, for example, in Europe, or in the United States,
yes,
we may look at templates or best practices.
Yes. Now, in which countries would you have this kind of a system, which obviously is a martial law imposition being operated in a democratic environment? Ha? Ayaw mo sabihin na ganun. Pero tama yun eh. So I asked the Dole, can you help the committee on this issue by giving us how this is being handled in other countries? You know, Southeast Asia may be a good example, not only because we are situated here, but we are in Southeast Asia, but because there are semi-authoritarian regimes all over the region. And I'm sure that we can draw some parallel examples. So that's why I'm asking the Dole to help the committee by coming out with this research material. Is that possible?
Yes, sir. Sir, in a week's time, we'll be finished with the comparative analysis,
mm-hmm,
particularly in the ASEAN because of the economic integration,
mm-hmm,
as well.
Yes.
And we will bring this to the technical working group, sir,
yes,
as we actually flesh out this particular provision. And thank you, by the way, sir, for actually trying to come up with this framework that even allows us to look back, you know, in the history, and because of some developments in the industry,
yeah,
we should be able to adapt and come up with certain flexibilities at this point. Thank you.
Yeah. Senator Dillon, I think sila ang ULSC, if I'm not mistaken, they had this comparative study on this particular issue,
yeah,
that you're
maybe
Sir Kamado can help us out.
Yes, Mr. Senator, we provided your office, no, and we provided the COMSEC with a comparative study on the ASEAN. We asked our legal counsel to do a matrix on about 5 or 6 countries,
mm-hmm,
and in most countries, they whenever they hire contracted employees, they merely notify the equivalent of the Department of Labor. And when they fire, they merely notify. There are no registration procedures. So that's the competitive environment that we face. So it's total flexibility.
Yeah, so that's precisely what I am looking for, especially in today's environment of ASEAN integration. We must be competitive, whether we like it or not. And with the industry represented by Ms. Marshall here, you know, all they have are laptops. Kung ayaw na nila, uwi na sila. And you will have 1 million of our countrymen in that situation. No matter what we say, huwag na natin isama yung mga bakla dito, si Ambassador, huwag na natin sabihin na saan mabits yung presidente ng ibang bansa. But or son of a warring ibang tingnan natin, you know, because the effects of those statements would not affect the long-term plans of industries like the BPOs if we have the right policies in place. Yun po ang importante. We can withstand this tawag sa atin, wow PI, sabi ni Dick eh. Sabi ni Dick Gordon, wow PI. George, ngiti-ngiti ka nung alam mong sabihin ng wow PI. Anyway.
Wow Philippine Islands, huh? It's wow Philippine Islands.
But what I'm just going back. These are the policy pronouncements that the investor will look at. It's not driving out the Americans out of our jurisdiction. it is the policy, because business will do business where the environment is favorable to them. But you prohibit absolutely contractualization. You know, even if with all the kind intentions that we have, if you're sitting in San Francisco and looking at the laws, ay talagang hindi ka napupunta rito. So we must be very, very careful about what we're doing here, because rhetorics cannot carry us through. It is the right policies in place which protects both labor and management that can make us move forward. And I can look at you all in the eyes, because when I was Secretary of Labor, I ordered the regularization of workers who were obviously being hired in violation of the labor code on labor-only contracting, ordered regularization of hundreds of employees then. But, you know, it's time that we look at our policies very carefully. And as I would repeat, this law today is a martial law regime imposition, which we still are trying to figure out what to do with in a democratic system of governance. So I just want to lay that framework, Mr. Chairman, for you to consider. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that very enlightening points by Senator Drilon. Again, we are aware of the security of tenure, that it is a constitutionally guaranteed right, but we wanted to balance also, and we make sure that we protect also the rights of the employers. Kanina ho, medyo nagulat tayo dun sa story na, alam nyo, hindi nga bago na naririnig natin, caught in the act na, nahuling nagnanakaw, hindi pa ma-fire. At nakakalungkot na parang dun sa scenario naman na yun, no? I'm not saying it's always the scenario, na nalulugi naman yung, dehado naman masyado yung ating employers at yung mga namumuhunan. Let me continue asking questions, no, dun sa mga supermarkets and the malls natin na nag-guess ngayon. Kasi balikan natin yung promodizers and the merchandisers. Pagka ba may Attorney Santos, Ma'am Elvira, pagka ba may mga additional tasks? Kunyari ho, hinire nyo sila as magbenta ng produkto o kung ano man yung gagawin nila. Tapos biglang meron kayong additional tasks na papagawa po sa kanila, for example, maglinis doon sa work premises. Sino po yung nagde-determine kung ano lang yung po pwedeng additional tasks na pwedeng ibigay dito sa mga contracted employees? Kasama po ba ito sa kontrata nila?
Mr. Chair, ordinarily, yung scope of work that to my knowledge, the scope of work of a promodizer is wholly determined by the instructions of their ultimate, or the company that hired their services. In this case,
the it's principal.
The, yes, their principal. In this case, their manufacturer or the supplier of whom the retailer has a relationship with, no? And ordinarily, sir, what happens is that their tasks are controlled by this entity, and the retailer should not impose additional tasks without informing the contractor. But it's to my knowledge that there are some retailers who do give instructions, so like clean the premises, but ordinarily this should not be done.
Actually, I'm raising this because I've experienced, no, may mga lumapit ho sa akin na ganun ho yung nangyayari, binibigyan siya ng additional tasks, and yet hindi naman alam ng contractor. Perhaps si Ma'am Caliwara can help us with this particular issue. Ano yung experiences niyo tungkol ho dito?
Your Honor, first and foremost, kung kami po ay kinuha yung, in-engage po yung services ng service contractor, kami po ang nagbibigay ng job description, coverage of the functions na gagawin po ng isang empleyado. Now, as to the additional...
Hindi po pwede magbigay, ayun, additional, yung additional
task. As to the additional task po, depende po yan eh. Kung like, for example, makikisama lang naman talaga yung employee sa kalinisan, sa cleanliness ng store, for example, or sa supermarket, then I don't think, which is not naman regular na trabaho po, or included in the task, supposedly, nung tao, then I don't think that's a problem naman with the principal or with the supermarkets or with the tao. But definitely po, the tasks and obligations or the job functions of the employee should be given and defined by the contractor, who is the employer.
Kaya ko tinatanong yan kasi may mga ilang pagkakataon na kung yung retailer mismo o yung owners mismo ng supermarket ang nasusunod, then dun sa pinag-usapan natin last hearing, then it should probably be the owners of the supermarket who would regularize yun sa dun sa mga empleyado na ating pinag-uusapan. Gusto ko lang hong tanungin din yung sa manpower service ng cooperatives. Meron ho ba dun sa merchandising and promodizing?
Yes, Your Honor.
And how many and what is the number of workers involved?
Well, I can only speak, siguro, Your Honor, for we have not broken down the distribution in like merchandising. I can only speak for my cooperative. So we have about 2,000 merchandisers spread over a couple of brands. Now, on your earlier question, who provides the training? We provide the training. So again, depending on the client, before we deploy, it is either 2 days to 1 week that they stay with us and train on how to. In merchandising, there is what you call facing, how you arrange the goods in a supermarket. So we have to train them. So we have to train them how to arrange, how does the client want the facing to appear? So we train. So we have professional trainers that are ex-employees of Unilever, ex-employees of Procter & Gamble. So we engage them to train these people. Then they are deployed. Then on a weekly basis, if they come back to the office and they have these weekly sales meetings. In these weekly sales meetings, if there is a new product that is introduced by the principal, then they are again trained on how to sell this product, how to push this product. So sometimes there are so many SKUs. So the principal will tell us, can we push the sales of this SKU? So we downstream that instruction to our merchandisers, and so when you walk by the supermarket, they say, "Ma'am, may problema dito. Ito. Or, limang produkto na gusto mong ibenta na. Dahil baka mag-expire na." So, those collaborations we do with the principal, but we deliver that and we control that. And then on a weekly basis, our cooperative reports to the principal. So we have our own system where this movement of inventory is tested to us and we supply this report. So basically, we envelope the service, we envelope the deployment of people with service. Meaning, if the principal can utilize the SKU by location, we deliver that information. If they tell us what is the best 10 selling product in SM North EPSA, we can deliver that. Because again, we look at ourselves, the cooperatives look at themselves as solutions provider. We do not merely provide one bodies. We try to provide a solution. So if these people need to push sales and we need to make the merchandiser as a salesperson, the cooperative will spend. Because by law, the cooperative is required to spend 7% of its net surplus to train its owners and we deploy that meaning power according to the needs of our clients. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, sir. Senator Dulan?
Yes. I'll ask a question which you may or may not answer. If we go back to the regime wherein the employer can hire and fire, which was what the regime was before martial law, would the employers still hire labor contractors?
Mr. Chua from the Federation of Philippine Industries Incorporated.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, allow me to thank Senator Drilon for his historical reference, which I think is very good to learn about. And in answer to your question, Senator Drilon, I had an opening statement which precisely said that contractualization was very expensive for us, no? In that whenever we contract agencies, labor contract agencies, we have to pay agency fees, which adds to our overall cost, no? And then we have to encounter many other difficulties such as retraining, and it's almost like having a new employee every time. So that makes us less competitive. And it's precisely, it's almost like kapit kami sa patalim because nga, ang hirap magpaalis ng empleyado kung nagkaroon ng problema, may problema sa attitude, may problema yung kumpanya o yung industriya, nahihirapan. So I believe the answer to that question is no. If we can have the ability to let go of people, whether we pay them a little separation pay or whatever, then we would take that option with open arms and will allow us to move into the 21st century with our competitor ASEAN neighbors and the other industrialized countries which have no such restrictions. Thank you, sir.
Would other employers care to answer? Ayoba.
Miss Jenny Marshall.
Thank you, Chair. So actually, right now, we're doing direct contracting for like seasonal employment, and then but we also, there are also clients that require us to produce a big number of, let's say, fixed-term employees or project-based employees within a short period of time. So like, for example, sometimes our foreign clients would say, I want 1,500 employees in 2 months. So it would be beyond the resources of the BPO company to hire that many employees. So we normally get one, even 2 to 3 manpower service providers or staffing agencies.
Anybody else? The Palascon, I assume, would not like that kind of a system.
What about SM and Pure Gold? Do you have any?
Yeah, in answer to my question, if we go back to the regime of providing flexibility to hire and terminate, provided the benefits are protected, retirement, separation benefits, would you still resort to labor-only contracting allowed under the present law, or would you now hire directly people and make them part of your payroll?
Having such flexibility, Senator, maybe that is something that our management may consider also. Something that we can really consider.
Siguro, in executive session without Palascon being around, you can have the more candid answer. Wala na? Oh, sige. Yeah. Oh, somebody's raising their hand at the back. Oh.
Mr. Dan Lachica of SAPI. Please, take your seat. He's the president of Semiconductor and Electronics. I know him because he's a partner of Tesla before. We were able to produce about 86%.
Semiconductors in 1974, all of them. I knew all of them. You're with what company are you, sir?
I used to be with the Lopez Group, but now I'm running the association, SAPI, the Electronics Industry.
And before that, were you in the semiconductor industry?
Yes, sir. First Philex Solar, First Sumiden, all of the First Philippine Holdings Group. Sir.
Ah, with the Lopez Group of companies.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay.
So thank you for recognizing me, Mr. Chairman and Senator Spinay and Senator Drilon. First of all, let me just give a background on the industry. In 2015, we still accounted for the biggest merchandise export, $29 billion, which is about 12% of our GDP. We employ about 350,000 direct workers and a total of about, direct and indirect, about 2.8 million. Now, in general, when we surveyed our members, about 43% of the workers are contractuals. No, they're hired through service agencies, and you know, if you're going to be taking out contractuals completely, that will be about a million unemployed people. Now, the nature of the industry is such that the window of the products is only about 6 months or so, and there's also this abnormal demand, just like our partners at BPO, for example.
Excuse me, the context of my question was,
yes, sir,
if the employers are given the flexibility that they used to have before martial law,
yeah,
in a democratic system, if they are given that flexibility, would contracting labor contractors still be necessary, as distinguished from contractual employees who are hired directly for a specific period? In other words, maybe the better question is, would you still hire indirect employees?
Yes, sir. I was getting to that. Sorry about that, Your Honor. But the last input I'd like to make is that, giving an example for this Note 7 issue, that's the kind of situation that would be hurtful. So, in other words, for the industry itself, we would really appreciate the flexibility to hire contractuals. And of course, if they are separated, to pay the appropriate separation pay, even the retirement pay as needed. So,
as long as it is not in violation,
yes,
of the,
yes,
right,
Your
to
Honor,
organize, that's not an unfair labor practice.
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, Senator Nancy, be nice, recognize.
Mr. Kimada, you mentioned that parang you have 2,000 merchandisers. Yung 2,000 who ba na yon, they get all the benefits of parang regular employees?
Yes, Senator, they get all the benefits of a regular employee, 13th month. What is the minimum wage, 13th month? On some clients, they're given sales incentives, so we give that to them. They get the 5-day service incentive leave, so they get all the pagibig PhilHealth. And on top of that, because we are a cooperative, we have our own HMO program, so which we provide to them. So every time they get sick, it's 40,000 per incident. And then on top of that, because they are owners and they have capital in the enterprise, we've been paying to the tune about, yes, dividends to the tune about 25% return on their capital. The capital is about 10,000, so we turn to them every year about an average of about 2,500. So, yes, we get, actually, in Manila, a regular worker would get about 500 something pesos all in. Ours, including all benefits, the members of the cooperative, we get about 620 to 630. So they get more, actually.
Thank you, Senator Nancy Binay. Again, we'd like to put on record that we all recognize the constitutional right of our workers, the security of tenure, and we are here to balance the security of tenure, accountability, and transparency of both employers and workers. Kanina ho nabanggit itong seasonal arrangements, no? Let me propound some questions on this particular topic. Binanggit kanina sa IT BPM, sa SAPI, meron din. Mas madalas kasi ito pag binanggit yung seasonal arrangements sa mga malls and supermarkets. How many seasons ba in a year you are observing? For example, sa SM or sa Pure Gold. And pag sinabi mong seasonal, I mean, yung bagger daw ba, sabi ni Senator Nancy, seasonal ba yun? Mukhang hindi naman, no? And how long is the term of seasonal employment contract? Ito ba'y 5 months, 3 months, 6 months, etc.
Mr. Chair, baka we can ask Dole, how do you define seasonal?
Ma'am, seasonal should be weighed against repetitive paulit-ulit na pag-hire, and therefore this is the reason why the Secretary Bellyho has really conveyed, no, our position na hindi dapat paulit-ulit ito, na to the point na papatakde na parang nagiging regular na. So for example, sa aming pananaw,
parang nagiging bad habit kumbaga.
Opo, sa aming pananaw, for example, yung practice na, for example, nagsimula ka sa Christmas, tapos New Year, tapos Valentine's, tapos sunod-sunod na ho, this to us is a questionable arrangement already. Yun ho ang gusto nating ihinto.
Siguro yun yung question ni Senator Nancy, no? Ano ba yung seasonal? Paano ito? Kasi in some industries, it's very clear. For example, if you are a resort owner in Boracay and summertime na, so kailangan mo ng madaming workers. Ngayong napakadaming bagyong dumadaan, siguro napaka klaro na hindi niya kakayanin na i-contain itong maraming workers na hinar niya during summertime.
Sige po. Thank you, sir. Sir, I'll request Attorney Benjo to elaborate and amplify on that.
Please, Attorney. Thank you. You're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and to our partners from the employer. So yung seasonal employment po talaga ay nagsimula po ito sa agricultural sector. But because of the change of workplaces, yung industry po ngayon, ay meron na rin po tayong mga needs that is only during peak or for a particular month or for a particular season. So we do not have a definite period how long a season is. O kung nagsisimula pa ang season sa January at natatapos po siya sa March.
Or baka iba-iba yan.
What we have is that we have a particular season in particular industries. So in one season in one industry may not be the same season in another industry. So what we are doing in the Department of Labor and Employment is to define parameters in identifying how long a season is.
And ano yung existing policy nyo towards seasonal employment?
Seasonal employment is one of the employment that is allowed by law. It's under Article 280 of the Labor Code of the Philippines. But we have Supreme Court jurisprudence when a seasonal employee is continuously rehired or rehired, he acquires regularity of employment.
I think yun yung gustong ipropound ni Senator Nancy Binay, you know? And perhaps we can ask again, pag kasi sinabi nyo, kanina si Asek Aragon also mentioned, no, hindi po pwedeng paulit-ulit or iimbentuhin mo. Kasi nga si Hallmark card, di ba, lahat na lang, merong season. Merong ngayong buwan na to, yung siblings month, bukas merong white hairs month, and all that. No? So I think yung gustong i-point out ni Senator Nancy is paano natin makikita na nagba-violate ito, no? And ang iba't ibang industriya, and siguro yung kanina I was trying to get an answer from mall owners, from supermarkets. Ano po ba yung pag sinabi yung seasonal, tapos siguro if you can enlighten us yung cycle of your business throughout a given year, ilan ba yung kinoconsider ninyo na ito seasonal yan, and perhaps just to give a bird's eye view, no, ng yung how many employees are needed in a given month or months of that year. Siguro you are from Yeah, can I just ask si Attorney Santos and if probably si Ms. Elvira. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. In retailing, retailing observes seasonal periodic ebbs and flows in our business cycle. During what we call the peak season, there are several peaks in the business cycle of a retailer. Most retailers experience their the busiest time of year during Christmas, and depending on the retailer, the retailer subsector, they may experience other peaks during enrollment or during summer. What do you mean during the summer season? So these are more or less the historic peaks where a retailer may expect a surge of business that requires it to hire additional manpower for the duration. There may also be periods of time where a retailer may decide to, for example, conduct promotional activities that it expects to generate a substantial increase in business over the similar period where such a promotion was not conducted. And in order to provide in order to make sure that the service levels that is expected of it are maintained, such a retailer may choose to hire additional workers for the duration.
Just one question. You mentioned that during peak season, you require additional manpower. Ano ba yun? The company directly hires or you go through an agency?
Depending on the practice of the employer, whatever practice is most comfortable with, he may hire directly or contact the service or service only contact. So it's entirely up to the judgment of the business.
What's the usual practice?
Hard to say, Senator, because as I mentioned nga po, referring to a service or contract is normally quicker because it gets there's a ready pool of workers already on hand to provide the service. But again, depending on the particular preference of the business, it may choose to hire directly. But one of the consequences of such a decision is that such hiring decisions must be made well ahead of time, in expectation of the period in which these employees are to be deployed.
Siguro, Mr. Chair, baka we can ask Pure Gold. Kunyari, for example, ngayon palapit na yung Pasko. Do you hire yung baggers,
yes,
diba? Ano yan? Outsource?
Yes, ma'am.
So okay. You hire
additional? For Pure Gold, Senator, we have defined two seasons for our supermarket. First is obviously October for the upcoming Christmas season. The additional workers would last up until January. And then on some stores, we also hire seasonal employees during school opening, which may start from I guess March for the summer season up until June of each year. And to answer again the question, we currently our practice is we're getting these workers from our service providers.
If they are hired as seasonal workers, does it mean na they are not entitled to benefits, 13 month pay, etc.?
For seasonal workers, based on our agreement with our service providers, they should still provide, we both of us would have to provide the basic minimum requirements. They receive minimum wage, they receive the proportionate 13th month pay, because the rule is upon serving at least a month, then you'll receive a proportionate 13th. Yes, it is, Senator. And then the appropriate government contributions for SSS PhilHealth.
Who provides it? Kayo ho o yung service provider?
Yung service provider po, Senator.
And you check yung na-hire nyo na service provider na talagang nagbabayad sila sa SSS, nagbabayad sila sa PhilHealth. Is that one requirement on your part?
Yes, in our service contract, we stipulate it that they have to strictly present to us monthly or quarterly their proof of remittances for these service workers that they deploy to PIRCO.
Would you confirm this, Ma'am Caliwara?
Your Honor, yes po. Being the employer of these people, we see to it that full benefits are being given to them. And in fact, we even encourage also, aside from the submission of the reports to the to our client companies, we also encourage also all our employees to check on the remittances that we made for them.
Thank you, thank you. Yes, Attorney Santos.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Yes, it is actually, sir, it is to our interest that to make sure that the service of the contractor complies with the payment of the statutory benefits. As you know, because of the joint and solidary liability concept in our labor law, that if the service of the contractor does not observe the statutory benefits, clients, principals like ourselves, will be liable for it. So our interest to make sure that they are compliant.
So Dole, pwedeng itanong lang sa Dole, yung whenever, for example, a mall would come up with the promotional seasons, magbabagsak silang presyo, etc. So kailangan nilang mag-hire. Allowed naman po yun, di ba? Supposed to be. Yes.
Opo. Chairman.
Siguro yung ipa-follow up ko lang, dun sa mga sa, for example, sa mall, no, ano yung breakdown ng masasabi niyo ito seasonal workers, ito yung talagang regular na kino-contract namin sa contractors? Do you have a breakdown?
For that question, Your Honor, I'm sorry, but I don't have the particular statistics to answer your question.
But you already defined how many seasons you have, pati yung mga sinasabi nyo kanina na parang yung mga biglaan lang na gagawin nyo na promos.
Ideally, sir, what kind of planning should have been conducted the year before the commencement of the calendar year? Because there are costs, sir, involved in the hiring of employees, and during the, ideally, even before the commencement of the calendar year, the succeeding calendar year, retailers already make plans as to what their activities will be for the upcoming year. That includes what kinds of promotions they may want to conduct. That also includes the kind of staffing levels that they may need to require. So all of this information is planned way ahead in advance, and it is very, in fact, it is bad practice for any business to conduct such a planning during the calendar year in which that event is to be conducted, unless there is a clear and present requirement for a business to do that.
Meaning to say, hindi talaga siya biglaan.
No, sir.
Na ginagawa. No? For example, kung bukas mapasa yung pagbababa ng personal income tax, the next month magpo-promo kayo, no? Balikan ko yung sa Pure Gold, no? Meron kayong breakdown kung ilan yung seasonal, ilan yung talagang regular na hina-hire po ninyo? Kasi kayo, define nyo kanina, binanggit mo, may dalawa lang kayong season.
It will actually depend, Senator, on the business performance of each store. And yes,
so iba-iba, hindi siya universal. Yeah. Kanina nagtaas ng kamay si Miss Mercedes Gagnon ng Kabisig Workers Cooperative. She is the vice chair. Ma'am, would you like to say something, or baka lang po nabanggit na naman yung position ninyo, o meron kayong gustong idagdag na hindi nabanggit? Sige po. Okay po. We'll allow you po. But this is not really the practice of this committee, but we wanted to hear your side as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Your Honor, for allowing me to speak, and Senator Binay. One of the industries that got neglected in the Philippines, where we were the prime before, is the garments manufacturing industry, primarily because of our labor laws that exist right now. We are not competitive. The garments industry has the highest, peaks and lows in terms of manufacturing. such that for them to come here, for the buyers to come here and invest with us to give the order to us, it becomes impossible because every time we hire, you know, with the tenure and all that, they become regulars, and that's a disadvantage on the investors that come here. Such that when Senator Drilon asked about the if we go back to we can fire and hire at our own convenience, that was the time when the industry was so big. Okay, and for now we are careful of hiring workers because of that 6 month period seasonality, but it's really seasonal. There's really a need for that, and if we do not recognize allowing the investors to hire and fire, you know, on the seasonal basis, then we could only get limited orders by which we are hampering the potential growth of the garment industry in terms of FOB. So given that, our cooperative, which is a workers' cooperative, not just workers, our workers are the manufacturers, we are the owners. It's a different concept as the labor-only co-op. And we are generating $86 million in a year. So that's a big thing. But if we are restricted with the contractualization thing, then we will have a big problem. That's all, Your Honor.
Thank you. Thank you. Can I just follow up on... Siguro just because we are pressed for time, I wanted to ask sana yung malls and supermarket representatives natin, perhaps if you can just submit to the committee na lang. I am really interested in the size of seasonal employees that you are hiring, you know. And I wanted to know if these seasonal employees complement yung employees with similar... similar scope of work, or perhaps nagiging iba na, no? But I think hindi naman surprising na pareho yung scope of work nila. Siguro gusto ko lang makita yung monthly size average, and what is the percentage of this over total size of employees. Kung pwede lang po, makahingi kami ng data from you to this committee, and perhaps we can correlate this with the sales of the malls or supermarkets, kahit hindi po, kahit yung percentage lang of increase of sales, para lang masiguro natin na, oh, ito merong season dito. And perhaps Dole can coordinate with this industries. Thank you. Senator Binay.
Kumakain. Mr. Vergano, hindi naman wala tayong security agencies member ng PADPAW. Tama ho ba?
Voluntary po ang membership.
So there's a possibility ho, yung mga hindi members ng PADPAW are practicing endo.
Hindi yun po. Kasi under the civil code kasi, they acquire regular status. And under the provisions of Article 286, we are mandated to reinstate them even after the termination of the contract. And failure to reinstate, these guards are deemed constructively dismissed, and we are mandated to pay separation pay. At mayroon po sila mga, mayroon po retirement ang mga gwardiya po natin. Lalo na ngayon sa Department Order Number 154-16, which was crafted for security alone.
Whether or not member ho sila ng PADPAW, tama ho ba?
Under DO-150 po ngayon, if they seek certificate of compliance, kailangan member po sila ng PADPAW or any security organization recognized by the Philippine National Police.
Siguro, ASEC Aragon, namomonitor niyo ba yung compliance ng mga security agencies?
Senator, opo, under our strengthened labor law compliance system, andito ho nakapasok ang aming mga labor inspectors. or labor law compliance officers? Yes, ma'am. We do this on a sampling methodology. Every year, we look at the universe and then tinitignan ho namin how we can do most effectively our survey. Meron ho kaming right now, as of date, we have our initial findings. I will invite our director for working conditions. I think he's around to give us even an initial, andyan ba? But,
director with us?
Yes, ma'am, we can submit to this honorable committee compliance rates relative to security, even janitorial, and other sectors, ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Senator Binay. I'm very interested with Sir Bergada's inputs and statements a while ago, and I think it is a model that we can probably replicate in other sectors. I have here with me a list of questions from Senator Risa Ontiveros Barakel. And let me just propound some of these questions to the Department of Labor. But perhaps before I ask some of these questions, if we can also get a status of this more than 12,000, if I'm not mistaken, regularized workers just recently. Saan po ba galing ito? Ano yung breakdown ito? Saan industriya? And just to ask one of Senator Risa's questions, yung current administrative procedure or process for deregularization of workers, malinaw daw po ba kung sino yung dapat i-regularized? Thank you.
Sir, Mr. Chairman, sir, yung 12,069 workers that we have regularized so far, through voluntary compliance and joint assessments and inspection, pwede ho naming ibigay lahat, pangalan, address, establishments, in this aggregated manner so that we can look at where in this, the industries where they come from. Of course, we have informed
prior. Sino po yung nag-volunteer, ma'am?
Opo. Sir, but this belong to the prioritized sectors dahil at the outset, nag-prioritize ho kami based on the prevalence of endo, kung saan ho yung mga practices na ito, and we have informed the committee as to where they are, hotels, restaurants, manufacturing, etc. We will give you, sir, ma'am, the complete list, and perhaps we're even looking at ways to make it public, no, ito hong listahan na ito.
Please, ma'am, kasi yung, for example, the only information that we are getting is from the media. Some of them are from 7-Eleven, if I'm not mistaken, 800, and another 4,000. I'm not sure if it's from SM or another mall. Is that correct, Your Honor?
Sir, dito sa figures na ito, ire, hindi pa ho kasama yung sa SM kasi mag-mandatory conference pa po kami, sir.
Pero yung process lang, no, nung regularization, importante talaga para ma-fast track po ito. And how many are we looking at right now? Yung estimate natin na mamare-regularize para siguro naman before Christmas masaya yung Pasko, mas masaya yung Pasko nila.
Sir, nung tinitignan ho namin ang affected industries and then we're looking at the universe and find out yung affected workers, parang nakikita ho namin we're a little over 10% right now in terms of regularization. Of course, we have a target with respect to the directive of the president. So I think the figure right now, which stands at 12,069, is a good figure, sir. And we will continuously update this honorable committee as to how we progress up to the end of this year, December 31 of 2016, and first quarter of 2017, sir. In terms of
please, and I'd like to associate myself with the views of Senator Ontiveros that the DOLE needs to establish administrative mechanisms to monitor the incidence of labor contracting in the country for the purpose of flagging possible breaches of workers' right to security of tenure. Yes, Senator Binay.
Mr. Chair, Asik Aragon, curious lang ako kasi parang apparently DOLE can already do it. So why do we still need the law?
Ma'am, yung first track nga ho namin yung strict enforcement of the law under 106 to 109. But nagiging effective po ito perhaps because of the voluntary compliance. Natutuwa ho kami because of the cooperation that we're getting both from labor and management. It's a very positive gain right now. However, we defer to the judgment of the legislative, sir, or the wisdom of this committee in particular as to how we can further strengthen our regulatory regime so that itong any form of circumvention, any kind of abuse, and especially with regard to labor-only contracting, Madam Senator, ma'am, if we can even fine-tune and give it more teeth, ngipin po, para hindi na po ito maulit and we can really give the labor adequate protection, then we will submit to the judgment of the Senate in particular, ma'am.
Mr. Chair, hindi yung ba bottom line, nagkakaproblema din ho tayo din sa implementation. Number one, wala naman ho napipenalize na company if they violate the law. Tama po ba yun?
Meron naman pong, in terms of penalties and sanctions, we have a mechanisms, ma'am, institutional mechanisms, suspension, cease and desist, possible.
Hindi, pero ilan lang mo yung napipenalize nyo?
Ma'am, we will submit to you the data. However, but you have made a very good point, Madam Senator, and perhaps through legislation, we can look at ways to even strengthen penalties and sanctions, again, under your wisdom, Madam Chair, Madam Senator. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, and I think malinaw pa rin kasi na kayang i-circumvent yung law. And as mentioned in the previous hearings, there is indeed a need to revisit and amend parts of the labor code, if I'm not mistaken, 106 to 109 at yung iba pang part. Siguro, let me throw this question sa concerned guests natin na narito. When you talk about classification of workers, is it advisable now? Kasi ang dami yung sinasabi, no? Kanina binanggit at napag-usapan natin yung seasonal workers. But I'm glad to hear from SM and the Pure Gold na even if they are seasonal workers, they enjoy all the benefits, the 13-month pay, the health benefits. I think that's the most important, no? If that's the case, why don't we call them or classify them already as regular workers, not just seasonal workers? Because anyway, they enjoy all the benefits of being a regular worker. Siguro mas magiging simplify kung regular na lang at probationary.
Mr. Chair, pero parang lumalabas ho, yung agencies, kayo yung regular employee, kumbaga regular employees nyo sila, hindi sila regular employee ng Pure Gold. So technically, they're still regular employees. Is that correct?
Your Honor, opo. All the employees na dinideploy po namin sa aming mga client companies are regular employees or the service contractors within the bounds of our contract based on the provisions of DO 18-A, which is yung co-terminus po. Now, in case lang po na yung client company ay based on the season nga ho, out of season na ho, hindi na ho kailangan yung services ng particular employees, then we could easily transfer to another client company po yung mga tao namin. So, kumbaga po, parang mas madali for the person, for the employees na makahanap ng instant na trabaho dahil kami po ay marami hong pagpipilian yung aming mga empleyado kung saan kumpanya at depende po sa kanyang skills at kanyang yes, sir.
Pero may mga instances, ba, for example, kunyari mga janitor, ang kontrata niya dun sa company is only 3 years. Ang kontrata niya ba dun sa janitor na yun is also good for 3 years?
Yes, Your Honor, based on the provision, as I said earlier, based on the provision po ng DO18-A, which is yung coterminous po. But if I may say it again, na kahit 3 years po lang siya doon sa particular client company na yon, we could easily transfer that person and get another employment being deployed po sa ibang client companies po namin. So mas madali, kumbaga para sa isang empleyado po, dahil mas sigurado po ang kanyang employment.
And then, for example, after 3 years, hindi nyo na nahanapan ng paglilipatan, do you give parang separation pay?
We do.
Benefit ba?
Opo, opo, Your Honor.
Thank you, Senator Binay. Very good points. Before ano lang yung sa Dole, no? Another question. If you have a program on program or information drive to help our workers to immediately proceed to the Department of Labor and Employment for livelihood assistance pag may mga ganitong problema.
Mr. Honorable Chair, you mean problema in the context of
yung na-terminate po yung kontrata nila due to non-registration by the DOLE. Nahuli yung contractor na hindi pala rehistrado sa inyo.
Yes, Honorable Chair, meron pong programa under the leadership of Secretary Bello. Meron po kaming tinatawag na Adjustment Measures Program or AMP. Ito po yung nangangalaga sa mga empleyado, manggagawa na nadi-displace or na nawawala ng trabaho because of this particular drive. Open po kami to serve the affected workers. Pinaikli pa po lalo at sinimplify ang proseso na ito para madali po ang eligibilities or makakuha ng benepisyo. Yun hong aming 24/7 na hotline ay magbibigay daan para sila ho ay makaugnayan namin. Yung livelihood programs po namin ay bukas.
That's good that there's a program, no, ASEC. It's just that siguro ako tulad ko, ngayon ko lang ho nalaman yan. Sana mas mapaigting pa natin yung information drive. ASEC, should the principal continue to engage the unregistered contractors and wait for an inspection or finding by the DOLE?
Unregistered.
Kasi if I'm not mistaken, no, I distinctly remember si Secretary Bello mentioned in the last hearing na yung contractor, yung principal, alam na naman niya whether or not registered o hindi yung contractor, eh, no? And I remember, I don't know if I heard this from Palscon or from other contractors, sila yung nagsasubscribe, nagsasubmit doon sa DOLE policies and procedures, pero yung ibang kahanay nila, hindi naman yun yung nache-check, no? And as mentioned in the last hearing, there are about 200 plus 300 plus na figures na nakitaan na hindi rehistrado.
Yes, Honorable Chair, that's why ang pakiusap po namin sa lahat ay mag-voluntary compliance na ho ang mga principals, in particular even the contractors, kasi ito ho, maganda nga ho ito na nagbo-voluntaryo sila, pero ho, alongside with this, hindi ho kami titigil sa mag-inspeksyon. Ito ho ang aming adhikain. This is what we intend to do in a very determined manner.
Thank you. No, balikan ko lang ho yung mga mining companies like Palscon. Nung last hearing po kasi, ang naging posisyon ng maraming labor groups, labor unions, ay itigil yung pagkakaroon ng contractor or mining agencies, at ang pinanggagalingan nila ay yung walang maayos na employee-employer relationship. Ang isa sa mga nabanggit doon sa pagdinig, nakaraang pagdinig, ay yung pagpayag nila naman doon sa kung ang ipinoprovide ng third party ay and same is true with the ULSC, no, ay tinatawag na specialized service. For example, if you are an owner of a building and ikaw ay magpapalinis ng iyong glass windows, hindi naman kailangan nung owner ng building na siya ang magkaroon ng itong mga scaffoldings, etc. So talagang i-contract out dun sa third party. But they were saying na pag hindi specialized service, dapat hindi doon sa third party. Anong position niyo dito?
Your Honor, while we agree with them na kailangan talaga yung mga, in other words, po, necessary and desirable, nandiyan na naman po yan.
Opo, gusto ko pong ibagit din kasi nandito naman si Sir Bergado. For example, kung security agent, kailangan ko ng security guards, isa akong kumpanya, hindi ako magte-train ng sarili kong security guards. Hindi ako bibili ng sarili kong mga barrel, mga gamit, equipment. Yun, I think yun malinaw po doon sa ating mga labor groups na acceptable po yun. But in other cases, doon sila pumapalag. So, yun, gusto ko malaman ano yung position niyo dito.
Your Honor, kasi what we offer as mga manpower providers po or service contractors po, yung flexibility po para sa mga companies, sa mga businesses, while ensuring the yung pong security rin ng mga tao in terms of job opportunities. While we, ang mga companies po kasi they want to focus on their core competencies eh. While they want na lang the manpower agencies or the service contractors to do the rest na lang for them. Because mas meron po kasi kaming mga ready pool of tao and mga skilled na po yan, trained na po yan, adequately trained, high skilled na po yan. So, mas madali po para sa, so many reasons po that we could give kung bakit kailangan pa rin ang services ng service contractors. But as I've said, most importantly, it's the flexibility po that we offer sa mga businesses.
Thank you. Any other... kayo po, sir, would you like to comment on that?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. We agree no, that it should be specialized. Not only specialization, but capital into the specialization. For example, the Union of Labor Service Cooperatives, we have 50,000 people in construction. And that 50,000 people, we provide their tools, their personal protective equipment. We buy equipment that do the rebars, we buy backhoes, we even invest in construction cranes. So we are now in the process, Senator, to secure even a pickup license. No, so we are, as I said from the very beginning, the cooperatives are looking at its business as a solutions provider, not as a pure provider of people. So we deploy capital, we deploy expertise. So that is our mindset. So in agriculture, my particular cooperative, we have 400 hectares dedicated to the biggest banana producer in this country. We have 60 trucks that haul back and forth the refrigerated vans. So it's we have gone away from just providing people. We are looking at our principles and looking at solving some of the problems and allowing them, as Ms. Roda said, allowing them to focus on what they think is more important to them. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Anything you want to add from DOLE, from CDA, DTI? With this particular issue, no, when you talk about specialized service, syempre ang magiging next question, who decides? Ano yung specialized service? It's very hard to define yung universal definition nito with different industries. Iba-iba yung, you have garments, you have IT, BPM, security, service, etc. There's a proposal na iba to ito doon sa tripartite, in a tripartite arrangements. Do you have any comment on this for the DOLE or... Yes, you have.
Mr. Chair, I think businesses should be allowed to define what they want to retain as their specialization. And each business is a particular situation. So to define a universal definition might be very, very difficult. And again, if the goal is flexibility and allowing businesses to flourish, let the entrepreneur, let the businessman make that decision.
Hindi pwedeng ikahon at hindi pwedeng pigilan natin yung pag-grow ng ating mga industriya at mga negosyo. Yan din po ang posisyon ng committee ito. So again, going back to the issue, kamusta po ba yung tripartite arrangement natin? Gusto rin natin iset yung tono na this really works.
Mr. Chair, matatag po ang ating mekanismo for tripartite consultation and social dialogue. Lalo pa po itong napatatag nung nagpasa kayo ng batas 2 years ago on strengthening tripartism. Kaya ho, at various levels, at different industries, meron ho tayo mga mekanismo, institutionalized, they regularly meet, so consensus building and recommendations can be arrived at. Pumupunta ho ito either sa Secretary of Labor at sa kanilang mga industriya for further vetting. Of course, this is not a static mechanism, and this should always be a work in progress. And therefore, under this leadership, we will further find ways and means to strengthen our tripartite discussion and dialogue mechanism, sir.
Thank you, thank you. Yung isa pang issue, no, na I think napag-usapan din dito sa ating pagdinig ay yung sa third party. For example, nandito ang PASCO, nandito ang ULSC, nandito rin ang PADPAW and other industries. Doon sa third party, pinag-usapan yung capitalization. Ano ho ba yung yung recommendation ninyo para sa isang kasi as of now ano ho yung present policy natin dito sa DOLE?
3 million yata ho ang nakalagay ngayon sa 18-A. Pwede ho natin tong lalong pag-aralan pa para tignan ho natin based on, for example, pwede natin itong makalibrate, sir.
Exactly. We wanted to balance everything out. Kasi we don't want to dissuade also yung mga maliliit na kumpanya, yung mga micro, small, and medium enterprises. So ito gusto natin na malaman, and this is your time to recommend to this committee your thoughts about it, Sir Bergado.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I agree with Asik Aragon that a study has to be done. And I suggest, Your Honor, that each industry should have their own tripartite council. Just like in the million of industries, Your Honor, as far as PADPAW is concerned, we are still the only number 15 industry with a tripartite council approved by DOLE. Now, in the case of Department Order Number 18, with due respect to the DOLE here, they established that, or they mandated that our paid up capital should be 3 million. And I checked upon Director Romy Montefalco of the Department of Labor. I asked him one time, Director Romy, will you please tell us what is the basis of fixing the 3 million? He said 150 guys. So I said, with due respect again, I think that is a wrong assumption. Why? Security agencies, we start from zero base, so why do we need 3 million paid up capital? We agree that gradually, yes. As a matter of fact, security industry is not only labor intensive, Your Honor, but we are capital intensive. Bihira po kami nakakabuhan ng 20 rupees on time. So we advance the payroll and the salaries of the guys. So capital intensive po ito. Kaya ulitin ko po, dapat lahat ng industry, mayroon silang tinatawag na tripartite council. Kasi dito lang po kami naintindihan ng DOLE noong nagkaroon kami ng tripartite eh. Kaya itong DOLE 150, specifically for security. At na-erase namin yung incentive fee to 20%. And retirement was an optional benefits now is a mandatory statutory requirement based on the Department Order Number 150. Kaya para ma-protect po ang discussion, dapat lahat ng industry mayroon po. And sad to think, Your Honor, there are million of industries. Kami pa lang po ang nakakuha ng number 15 na tripartite. Kaya dapat po, yung ibang industry dapat magkaroon para mapatalaman po, maintindihan ng gobyerno. What is, like for instance, yung mga ibang mga industries dito, para maintindihan po, what is really the business? Like for instance, kami po, multi-faceted kami. And in this business, there is a unique situation. Na kami, pag yung gwardiya nga sakop ng isang kontrata, pag na-terminate or hindi na-extend, they remain our employees and we are mandated to post them. Now, failure on our part, we are mandated to pay the price and pay. Ganun po, Yura. Thank you.
Thank you. I think it's important to note the importance of tripartite arrangements. And kanya si Senator Nancy is asking how many industries pa ba yung walang ganito at what can
or,
we do?
Or Mr. Chair, anong industry lang ang may tripartite?
Actually, Mr. Chair, magandang tanghali po. Good afternoon. In the national level, we have 9 ITCs, but we have 288 local industry tripartite councils. But for policy making, it would be best that it be at the national level. So we would like to inform this committee that we are also planning to come up with other ITCs in the national level. What are these ITCs in the national level? One of which is the private security. We also have that in the for the OFW land base. We also have from the maritime ITC, clothing and textile ITC. We also have banking ITC, and we have for the construction ITC, Mr. Chair. So ito po yung mga malalaking industriya. Hotel ITC. Ulitin ko pa. Banking ITC, Mr. Chair.
Security.
Hotel. Hotel and textile. Hotel, textile, clothing and textile for construction. Maritime.
OFW.
OFW land base.
Dalawa pa
ulit. Ano pa yung iba? No, hindi broadcast. Hindi broadcast. Nakalimutan ko.
9.
Sige po.
Mr. Just furnish us a copy.
So yes, yes, sir.
So for pang DPOs, wala pa.
Not yet, Your Honor. But in the regional ITC, we have regional ITCs.
Yung mga semiconductors.
Particularly in Davao and Cebu.
Semiconductors.
Not yet, Your Honor.
I think this is important considering that we heard from Dr. Sir Lachica that they also are into this kind of scheme, no? Mm-hmm. Kanina no, tinatanong natin yung tungkol dun sa capital kasi it is important because we have to make sure that contractors have the capacity to pay salary of all employees and yung isang key din dyan na hinahanap natin, they are capable in acquiring equipment, yung facilities, etc. for training. Kaya ho din, I think we need to really look into this. Do you have anything to add, Sir Quemado, please?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chair, if we're looking at the welfare of the workers, then the service providers need to be highly capitalized. We have to look at this service industry just like banking and insurance. Now you protect the depositor, you protect the plan holder. Therefore, the banking regulator, the insurance regulator, require a highly capitalized institution. So, for example, right now the 3 million can only pay 300 workers. You put up to 10 million, you pay 600 workers. That's for 30 days. What if the principal is delayed? Who suffers? It's the worker. So our proposition, our position in the cooperative movement is to raise this and to scale it. So meaning if you increase the number of people that you deploy, therefore any business, you have to put in more capital. You cannot rely, we do not subscribe to relying on the principal to pay you on time. Because there are exigencies in their own business. So our position, Mr. Chair, is that capitalization has to be raised to a certain level and that it has to be scalable. And we also subscribe to DO18A, where there is that concept of net financial contracting capacity. So because that enables, that controls the contract, cannot, the contractor cannot just get any contract beyond its contracting capacity. I think that it's a beautiful concept. I think in any proposed legislation, it should be there to determine the capacity of the contractor. Because at the end of the day, it is not the contractor that suffers. It is the worker that suffers.
Very good points. Of course, we'd like to put on record also that we subscribe with the BMB law, the minimum wage law, yung mga exemptions din po sa mga small and medium, micro, small, medium enterprises, etc. But just hindi ko lang mapalampas. What's the average size of employees per service provider? Would you know?
Per
average size? As the number of employees for a particular service provider. Yung average lang po, hindi yung malaking, masyadong malaki yung ULSC.
Kami po, Your Honor, sa Palscon, we are averaging around 1,000 to 1,500 per service contractor.
So definitely 3 million is very small.
Ang 3 million po, Your Honor, is good for 150 people only for 1 month lang din po.
Thank you. Any other? Oh, yes.
Sir, sinulat na po namin kung ano yung mga ITC. We have 9. For the land-based and sea-based, these are 2. Banking ITC, maritime ITC, clothing and textile ITC, construction ITC, hotel and restaurant ITC, sugar ITC, and private security ITC po.
9 po.
Sige, thank you. Siguro yung last point lang, no, kanina dun sa pinag-usapan natin, yung mga additional tasks, I just want to flag it with the Department of Labor, because I've been getting a lot of these stories, complaints, na, for example, dun sa mga food chains, ma'am, sir, bibigyan sila na parang every day you have 15 minutes na parang ayun ang bag doon sa kumpanya, 15 minutes a day ng paglilinisin, etc., pero hindi kasama doon sa binabayaran sa kanila. So I'm sure we will be inviting you to look into this in the next couple of weeks. But anyway, if there's any other comment or anything you want to add, Senator Binay?
Siguro, Mr. Chair, curious lang ako, gaano kabilis mo makakolekta yung mga service agencies?
Senator, slow.
That's why kailangan mahaba mo yung PC.
That's your capital. Hours, 45 days.
Ms. Caliwara.
Most of the client companies po namin are paying mga 60, 90 days. Sometimes they even pay us on 120-day term. Ganun po sila, Your Honor. So as mentioned kanina po, highly capitalized po ang industriya po namin, ang aming pong negosyo. Kaya in fact, base po sa substantial capital na nasa DO18-A po na 3 million is not that sufficient po para sa isang service contractor, considering that it's hard talaga to collect. Thank you, Your Honor.
Mr. Brigado po.
Maganda po yung tanong nyo, Madam Senator. Kasi,
you know, sabihin nyo sa gobyerno, baka sabihin.
Lalo na po sa gobyerno. Umabot po ng 3 months, 6 months, hindi po kami nababayaran. Well, I agree with the gentleman and the lady na kailangan po substantial po yung puhunan or capital. Pero pwede po natin i-arrange para sa beginner, hindi po ganun kalaki. Dapat gradual. It is not fair to our principal na million sila kami, ganito lang. Pero sa simula po, we start from zero base. So ang point ko, hindi po pwede na 3 million kagad. Pero as we go along, Your Honor, pwedeng i-require magdagdag para in fairness to our principals. So, ulitin ko po, ang mabigat po nito, pag hindi po kami nakakolekta, Your Honor, we prioritize salary of the guards. Now, we delay the remittance of the SSS premium. Ang problema po, we are meted out the penalty 3% per month ang binabayaran po namin sa SSS na penalty. Kaya talaga ina-update po din namin yung sweldo ng Guardia. Kasi malulugi na po kami, nagbabayad pa kami ng 3% per month.
Okay po. Thank you. At tuloy natin yung debate na yan sa ating TWG. You want to add something? And then CDA. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. To refer back to what I discussed earlier regarding the seasonality of the retail business, I may have given the impression that the seasonal nature of the business, meaning the two peaks that I identified, Christmas and school enrollment, are fixed and are not affected by other externalities. But because of certain circumstances that have cropped up in the past few years, the volume of business that we expect during these periods have been affected. Let me cite, for example, the case of school enrollment, where we would expect a spike in business probably beginning around April through May, because the school season for many years from elementary, high school through college was fixed. But with the changes in the timing of the start of school year for college, which now begins in September, and for grade school and high school, whose commencement still begins in June, this period has been split. So as you can understand, instead of having just one peak for enrollment, we now have two peaks. No, that's one. And second is Christmas season. Again, this is the high point of the business year for any retailer, but we are seeing changes in the volume of business that we are generating during this period because all because of climate change. It's been observed that during this period, instead of being typhoon-free, in the past 3 years, we are seeing storms and typhoons that are affecting the factory during this period, for affecting our business. So, again, because of these changes, it's difficult to pin down exactly hiring levels that a business may want to deploy during this time because of these externalities. Thank you.
Yes, we'd like to hear from the Executive Director of CDA.
Good afternoon, Senator Villanueva, Chair, and Senator Binay. In behalf of our Chairman, Chairman Orlando Rabanera, we would like to extend our many, many thanks for allowing us to express our peace in this August committee. We would like also to thank the Chair and the committee for allowing the Workers Cooperative and at the same time the Labor Service Cooperative to have their peace here. This is we understand that it is also a recognition that the cooperatives are contributors to national economic development. We have 3 points to raise, and number one, we would like to express that we agree with what the gentleman from the Union of Labor Service Cooperatives has discussed a while ago, the finer points of their operation. And number one, we would like to reiterate our stand that employees are co-owner in labor service cooperatives. Employees are co-owners with rights, privileges, and collective prerogative, not only as employees, but as employers also. Number two, employees, owner employees enjoy two-tiered benefits. They are not only because they are not only employees but also employers. They are owners. And number three, labor service cooperatives are in themselves the expression and working of the right of self-organization as provided for by the Constitution. This is expressed specifically through trilateral arrangement being observed by the LSCs and their employers. Their partners, partner businesses. and which provides conditions that the workers can organize themselves into cooperatives of their own and express the self-organization principle through their dialogical processes in their policies, in their procedures, and in accordance with their bylaws. Maraming salamat po at maginahapon po sa inyong lahat.
Salamat po. Executive Director, yes, ma'am. Elavaso, ilan ho ba yung labor service cooperative?
Sa ngayon po, meron po tayong record, according to our records bank, we have cooperatives engaged in labor service activities at the count of 380 cooperatives po.
And usually, what industry?
Iba't iba po yung kanilang meron sa malls, meron pong iba't ibang services po ang kanilang pinoprovide, meron sa construction, at iba pang mga industries po, ma'am.
May napinalize ho ba kayo na cooperative kasi they're practicing unfair labor practices?
Although, doon po sa puntong yun ay hindi po namin jurisdiction yung pag-determine kung merong unfair labor practice, ma'am. Ang alam ko po ay sa DOLE, ang kanila pong, sa amin po, yung cooperative operation lamang po. Kung papaano po ni sila gumagalaw bilang kooperatiba, meron po ba silang mga general assemblies, meron po ba silang mga patronage refund and interest on capital, democratically owned ba sila, yun po yung tinitingnan namin sa governance, ma'am. But as to specific unfair labor practices, hindi po namin na pinapasok po yung area na yun. Although, maaari po kaming makipag-coordinate sa DOLE because we are also in partnership with the DOLE when it comes to the implementation of the labor laws and cooperative laws po.
Yeah, tama po yun, Madam Chair. Because the moment a cooperative assumes the personality of an employer, yung mga miyembro po niya ay considered din po mga employee. So any illegal practices na ginagawa po dun sa mga empleyado, yung under the labor code, covered po yun ng inspection system po.
May data ba kayo kung ilan yung complaints coming from the cooperative sector?
Actually po, ma'am, nakikita po namin ito through joint assessment and compliance visit. And isa po sa mga, siguro po last week, we found 7 who are in violation of DO18-A.
And pag may violation hong ganun, opo, pwede nyo ba i-revoke?
Nagkakaroon po kami ng pakikipag-usap sa DOLE. Actually po, ma'am, ngayon po ay ang aming pong pamunuan sa pamamagitan po ng aming chairman ay nakikipag-usap kay Galang-Galang Secretary Bello para po magkaroon ng memorandum of agreement ang Cooperative Development Authority at ang Department of Labor and Employment para sa magandang pag-implementa ng ating po mga labor laws maging ng cooperative law.
Tama po yun, madam, because kapag isa pong kooperatiba ay nag-engage sa contracting and subcontracting business, covered na rin po siya ng DO18-A. And we also have that power to deregister that kapag mayroon po mga violation.
I guess yung mga labor service cooperatives, nag-register din yan sa DOLE?
Dapat po kung nag-engage po sila sa contracting and subcontracting business. That is the act of finding out the completion or performance of a particular job, work, or service. Pero kung hindi po yun yung business po nila, they need not register under DO18-A.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator Binay. Thank you po sa inyong lahat. I think the kanina, napakadami nating na-raise dito sa hearing na ito. I think the historical context provided by Senator Dulon is very interesting, given that what we need to do is, we need to do here is, to balance the ability of employers to achieve efficiency in operation, but at the same time also protect the welfare of our workers. What we want is, of course, increase productivity and promote economic growth, but at the same time we want to prevent unjust practices against workers in a manner that is supported and promoted globally. Rest assured that this committee will do its best to achieve the balance between efficiency of operators and protecting and promoting the equity of workers. Right now, as the chair of the committee, I'm seeing that this can be done. the security sector was able to regularize their security guards, provide benefits, and at the same time efficiently operate. There are some key features that we were able to tackle. One is that contractualization can be limited also to specialized sectors. We have to also ensure that contractors have the sufficient capital to provide for the salaries and benefits of workers, and at the same time invest in equipment necessary to provide the services they offer. Number three, increase or improve efficiency in evaluating employees and resolving labor issues, including transparent separation terms and upfront payment of termination fees. Number four, following the model of the security sector, regularize workers, pay regular salaries and benefits, and ensure their right to organize. Fifth, yung simplification of employee classification. Baka po pwede nang gawing dalawa na lang, regular and probationary, because as we mentioned a while ago, yung seasonal and project-based workers can actually fall under regular. Lastly, we should have appropriate penalties to discourage bad practices of contractualization. And so at this juncture, I'd like to instruct the committee secretary to convene a technical working group so we can consolidate the bills with these key provisions, with the goal of producing a committee report before the end of the year. Again, I'd like to thank everyone for attending this hearing and providing your inputs. We hope for your continuous support and participation in the TWG. Let us work together in achieving a balance in making sure that our industries are profitable and competitive, and at the same time ensure that our workers also benefit from our profitability and economic growth. Maraming salamat po sa inyo at magandang tanghali. God bless us all. This meeting is adjourned.